Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah. My dear wonderful people, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. As usual, this is your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. We live in the West here, or you can live in the East, but the West has taken the upper hand, and everything that is produced here in the West is reaching the entire world, either through music, through the movies industry, the entertainment industry, or worst, games and everything. So everywhere you go is the West present there. In this culture of the West, as it brings a lot of good, it actually brings also lots of evil. Sometimes you get something good, but the little evil that is in it spoils the majority of the great good. And this is where Islam has come, to protect people from the abuse of mankind, from the abuse of the ego, from the abuse of making money on your back, from the abuse of putting people down to work for you as you enjoy life and they struggle. Al-Islam, my dear brothers and my sisters, has always protected and safeguarded six elements. These six elements are what the scholars always go to whenever they want to issue a fatwa. My brothers and my sisters, Al-Islam has and is and will always be here to protect and safeguard six elements. These six elements found everything that we are gravitating around. The first one is your religion. Al-Islam comes to protect and safeguard your religion, either as a Muslim or as a non-Muslim living in your own country or in my country. There is this general belief that we Muslims, once we establish an Islamic country where we have like our country, when once everything is going fine and we have worshipped Allah perfectly well and the sky is raining gold on us, everything is going happy. The next thing is, okay, which country are we going to go and kick their butt to make them come to Islam by force? And this is actually very untrue. Islam was never meant a religion of get strong and then get your teeth out and go bite people to make them come to Islam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't do it, and after him, as-Sahaba. All the battles of Islam have been always as a self-defense. There is not a one single expedition or battle in the history of Islam, at least at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that's whom we go by when we talk about Islam. It is sad to say that throughout history, Muslims have abused the powers given to them by Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, and they have oppressed many countries around the world, many nations, in the name of Islam. The sad news is these events that a lot of Muslims today are not aware of are actually documented in the books of history, and the West looks at them. The West looks at the books of what Muslims have done when they were strong to find out what it is that they will do when they get strong, and this is why everyone is against the Muslims taking control and power. For example, these days, if you go on YouTube, and this is like a very, very strange and very dangerous element, you find in Egypt what they do nowadays is satellite stations and TV stations bring two people, the extremes, a very good sheikh about the long beard and wearing the thobe and everything representing Islam as you'd like to think it is Islam. And on the other end, somebody else who either is a Muslim and has got like some kind of extreme thinking. And they put them together and the conversation goes, and many times the Muslim scholars get so angry that they take off their shoes and they want to smack the other one with their shoes right on the television. People are watching. People are watching. This is unbelievable. The message that gets sent to the world from that thing there is that when we Muslims get to the power, if you don't agree with us, we are going to cut your head. If today on television, I'm going to smack you with my pair of shoes. And in Egypt, my brothers and my sisters, telling somebody you are a pair of shoes is actually worse than telling him you are a donkey or you are an animal. So here we see that there is this trail of the so-called scholars that have knowledge in the head, but attitude, nothing. My brothers and my sisters, in Islam, we have this thinking, especially today. I am good with you as long as you agree with me. When you disagree with me, that's it, I become your enemy. And that pictures there or those clips are widely spread on the internet and people are actually using them to their ends. If today they're going to smack ass with their pair of shoes, what are they going to do tomorrow when they are in power? And this is why nobody would want Muslims to get to the power. Islam, my brothers and my sisters, came to protect six elements. Your deen, i.e. we cannot force anyone, as I said. We cannot tell someone to forcibly believe in Allah, we're going to decapitate them. That's not true. We have no right to making fun of any deity. For instance, in India, they worship the cow. To me, this is something like that. How can a human being worship a cow? What's wrong with them? Even though I believe it's wrong, even though it is haram to do that, but I have no right to mocking up their religion. Because Allah has forbade it in the Quran that you insult and you make fun of their religion, they're going to insult Allah adwan. And they will, by oppression, and who's going to carry the broken pieces? You, my brother, who has been the reason. If somebody worship the cow, I live in with him and his cow. I do my little dawah, he doesn't want to respond, she doesn't want to respond. He is a human being. I interact with them in what is covenant and normal between me and them. And the rest of their belief, I leave them to Allah. I am not here the sheriff with a machine gun to people believe or I kill. We are not licensed to kill. The second point, my brothers, is the mind. Your mind, Islam came to keep and protect your mind. Anything that messes up with the mind is haram. This is why alcohol is haram. This is why drugs are haram. This is why brainwashing is haram. This is why anything that plays with the mind is haram. Because it takes the brain from its functionality and takes it into a realm where the brain does not have all the elements to make the right choices. Today, in part of the fun of people is they go to clubs. In clubs, you have very loud music, lots of colors, lots of lights, and a lot of booze, alcohol. And what happens there? The brain gets there, all these elements get confused and get for one single end, وَالْعَيَّدُ بِاللَّهِ haram sexual intercourse and haram acts of disarray and demise. So my brothers and my sisters, Islam came here to safeguard and protect your brain. Anything, even if a game where the game programs the brain into some kind of element, for example, hatred. That game, if it programs and affects the brain of the kid, and today I see a lot of games on PlayStation where it's all around killing. Kill this, kill that. All these games, my brothers, if they lead to the behavior of the child, they are haram because they mess up with the brain of the kid. And so are movies that mess up with our brain and so on and so forth, and you get the idea. Number three that Islam came to protect is the self, you as a human being. And this is why it is haram to fight, to punch somebody before England make it a law. In Islam, it is haram to make another human bleed. On the day of Qiyamah, the very first ruling, the very first account that is going to be cleared is the account of blood. And this is before even you meet Allah to have your accounts looked into it. So my brothers and my sisters, anything that harms a human body is haram. Even in Islam, it is haram to scare a Muslim even by joking. We are not allowed to hide behind the door and scare a Muslim. We are not allowed to, Muslim or non-Muslim in that matter, a human being. It's haram to point a weapon towards a person, Muslim or non-Muslim again. For example, if you're talking to somebody and a knife in your hand and you don't even mean that, you are being cursed until you put down the knife or the weapon or the stick or the rock or anything that is harmful to human beings. It is haram. Why? Because that is a cut in the way of Islam to tell you do not harm your fellow humans. Number four that Islam came to protect and safeguard is the family. Family, family and family. And by the family here, I mean al-ird. Don't talk about the woman or the husband of another person. Don't backbite. Don't cause any problems. Anything that attacks the honor of a man and a woman is haram, even jokingly. Even jokingly, it is haram. Today we live in a lot of things. Have you seen this? Have you heard that? Have you heard what people say? And what you have you heard or what they said somebody else did? So my brothers, pay special attention to this one and my sisters. Number five, Islam came to protect and safeguard your wealth. This is why paying taxes on the wages is haram. Tricking people and taking their money by deceit is haram. Borrowing money from people with the intention of not returning to them is haram. Making people spend money in something that is not good for them or does not bring the benefit that you say is haram. Selling something to somebody and making false claims is haram, 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 haram. Anything that helps you take money out of a Muslim or non-Muslim is haram. Don't do it, because Islam came to protect the hard-earning money that people make and that Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala gives to them. And the number six, blood, i.e. the life of people, you are not allowed to kill at all. And Islam has set the rules when someone should be killed, and we cannot go beyond that point here. My brothers and my sisters, because we live in the West, or as I said, the world today is predominantly by the West, i.e. by people who don't believe in Allah the way they should. One of the things that people are having problems with in the West is this thinking that they made dua to Allah and Allah did not answer the dua, i.e. Allah doesn't exist. Or Allah took one of their members of the family. Why is he so cruel? If this is the all-loving God, why is he doing this? He's horrible, miserable, and terrible God. I don't believe in him. That's it. I'm done with this belief. And sadly, this belief is rubbing up on Muslims. Muslims nowadays don't respect Allah as he ought to be. I lost my dad and I still can't get over the fact that my dad died. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who has given. Don't you think that he is also the one who can take whatever is his? If someone leaves with you a cat and then another day takes it, why do you throw a whole tantrum party about why they took their own cat? Like the non-Muslims today, I made dua to Allah and he's not answering. And deep inside us, we get into that point where we don't believe Allah answers our dua. And actually, this is the biggest betrayal that you can have against yourself and against your own God. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at the world from a complete different angle than what you look. Don't think yourself as you are the only human that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to answer your dua when you want it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has got gazillions upon gazillions. يَدْعُوهُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Anything that is in the heaven and the earth, any creation apart, will ask Allah. Except the one who doesn't ask is Allah. He is the only one. Everything else asks Allah. Your questioning and your asking, my brothers and my sisters, does not have a priority unless you fulfill certain conditions. And those conditions raise your status. Today, people, to get in a house with the council here in England, you need to get into this point system. You earn points. You have kids, you get points. You are disabled, you get points. And this, to raise you up to the beginning of the list. Well, the same thing with Allah. Don't think just because you are a Muslim that Allah will answer your dua. Don't think because you've gone through difficulties that Allah will answer your dua. You must fulfill certain conditions before that. These conditions is to watch out the six elements that Islam came to protect and safeguard. And these are, as I mentioned earlier on, and they are your religion, your mind, yourself, your family, your honor, wealth, and your blood. How much are you giving to Allah to ask that Allah gives you quickly as you give him? Now let's play this fair game. How are you doing with the commands of Allah on 1 to 100%? When Allah commands you something, are you one of these people, I am in a bad habit, I need to change that? When I tell you this is kufr, don't say it, you tell me it's a bad habit, and then you want to make dua to Allah and expect a quick response? What's wrong with us? The salat, we don't perform it properly. We don't even know what sami'a Allahu liman hamidah. We don't even know what it means. Believe me, ask yourself what it means. If I told you what it really means, you're going to smack your head for praying years without knowing what it means. And then you want Allah to respond to your dua straight away? No, my brothers and my sisters, we have to come to our senses. Otherwise, your children. Look, the sequence goes this way. Your parents didn't have much knowledge. You are today playing here and there, and you hear this and you get like what you think is knowledge, but it's not knowledge. What you are transferring to your kids is superficial knowledge. Your kids, when they come there, they're gonna turn like the Christians because they see how the Christians are. I've already heard it from Muslims. I made a dua to Allah, but he didn't answer why. I've heard Muslims asking Allah why he didn't do that. Why isn't he answering? All these statements are statements of kufr, as Allah says in Surah Al-Anbiya. لا يسأل عما يفعل. Allah is not to be asked about why he does what he does when he does it, how he does it. My brothers and my sisters, you really have to open your eyes. Today's pep talk is this: see where you are, see where you are, see where you are from the six elements. How much are you respectful of the religion of Allah, and how much are you taking care of the trust of that deen that Allah has given you? Your mind, what are you doing to nourish your mind? How good are you doing to your mind? How much are you investing in that mind that Allah made the malaika prostrate to it, the angels to prostrate to it? Come on, honor this mind that Allah has given you. Allah has given you more value than you can ever comprehend. All the angels in the heavens have prostrated to you in the form of our father Adam in recognition of the power of the mind. And you today, you sit down and you trust your mind to a shaitan and just looking for vain things in this life. And then you come back to Allah on the day of Qiyamah. I didn't know, I couldn't see, I was not able to. Oh, come on, this is like pure ignorance altogether. And also the self, how are you doing with your body? What are you doing? How much are you taking care of this body? When you return it to Allah, are you going to return a very fat and healthy body? Or are you going to return a slim, nice, trimmed, healthy body? Your behaviors on all these things. Your family, how much are you taking care of this family? Are you honoring your family, your wife, your children? Are you observing in them the laws of Allah? Or are you a piece of deep, cheap tissue that you don't even know how to deal with your family? Then Allah will ask you about that. That. And also your wealth. What are you doing with the wealth that Allah gives you? How much are you spending to support the religion of Allah? How close are you to the religion of Allah? And when it comes to spending, that man, when Allah tabaraka ta'ala in Surah Al-Hadid, the iron says, "Man dhal ladhi yuqridu Allah qardan hasana?" Who is the one that is going to lend Allah a very good, nice lending? What did the Sahabi said? He said to Rasulullah, "Ya Rasulullah, ayas'aluni Allah qardan? Is Allah asking me to lend him money?" Rasulullah said, "Yes." He went straight away back home and he told his wife. They had this huge garden, and garden at that time had palm trees, had everything that was the livelihood. It's like a factory. And he told to his wife, "Pick the kids up, get out of this garden." And she goes, "Yes." He goes, "That's it. Someone has asked me to lend it to him, and I have accepted." And the woman gets out happy. And then when she knew that her husband has actually given that garden, lent it to Allah, she was absolutely pleased. Pleased. And today when I tell you, donate £100 to print a newsletter, nobody comes forward. And then we say, "Ya Allah, give me." Come on, my brothers, we need to wake up. We need to wake up. Nothing in this life gets started without jihad. And jihad here is exerting yourself to do what it takes to do, to fulfill and to make happen whatever needs to be happening. And the number six, life, honoring Muslims, killing Muslims, and we eating in their honor and everything. My dear brothers and my sisters, let me tell you something where we are living today, and I close my thought with this one here. There is a band, an American band called REM. They made a song called "Losing My Religion." This song is widely misunderstood because you have to have lived in the United States or know the culture to understand what losing my religion is. The most precious thing in a man's kind, Christian, Jew, or Muslim, is religion. It is an expression in the southern states of the United States, or the Dixie states, i.e. the southern states, in the Civil War of the United States. They start from Texas all the way to Delaware, a little bit southern of New York State. That expression of losing my religion, when you are in total dire situation, and usually it's a love and emotional expression. When someone loves somebody, either a man loves a woman or a woman loves a man, but the love is not returned as it ought to be, one of the two will do their best to be loved or gain the love of the other one. So much so that, like today we use, is like, "I'm losing my marbles, I'm losing it all. That's it, man, I've lost it. What I have lost it is like, I have traded everything of value to me until it got to the point where I was ready to trade in my religion to get out of that person what I want." So losing my religion is nothing else but an expression to say, "I'm losing my temper, I'm losing my civility, I'm losing it all." But people today, and as shaitan has banged big deal on this, people think it's, "I've lost my religion," i.e. I made dua to Allah, he didn't accept my dua, I've lost my religion. And tons of people out there, non-Muslims, they believe losing my religion is as it is. And this is why people find it very, very, like it's a rebellious song against the church, when it actually means, I've just lost my temper. We live in a very dangerous time. We live in a very dangerous places. So I wanna say to you, my brothers and my sisters, learn Islam. Learn the true Islam. Don't learn some kind of superficial Islam. Get deep to your aqidah. How do you do that? Wear a pair of glasses called tawheed. Analyze everything of the tawheed and never ever have someone repeat twice to you a command of Islam. Once is enough. Once is enough. Once is enough. That is haram. Stop it. Don't use another time. I have to remind you, it's haram. Oh, it's a bad habit. No, it's not a bad habit. If I told you that thing there will cost you £1, you never ever turn to me and waste £10 and you tell me it's a bad habit. If I tell you it's £1, you'll remember it. You'll remember it. When I used to teach the Arabs that came from the Middle East English, they mixed between the P and the B. So instead of saying park, they would say bark. So in me, I'm teaching, I tried all techniques to make them realize that the P and the B are not the same. So I go park, they go bark. So I found out the different ways. I started like this slow. 50 pence every time they pronounce the B, P or the PB. When I started touching their pockets, the very first few times they made the mistake. And then I told them after 10 mistakes, it goes to £3 for one error. Nobody made it to £3. Everybody started now paying attention to the P and B, and some of them would stand and they look at the word and they make and they learn the difference between the P and the B. Are you waiting until I tell you every time you make a mistake in your tawheed you pay £100? Is that what it's gonna go down to? Well, if it's going down that way there, my brothers and my sisters, your Islam is really in danger. So from this pep talk here, my brothers and my sisters, if there is one thing here, pay attention to what Islam came for and pay attention to what you call bad habits. They are not. It's just who you think you are. Until tomorrow, spend the rest of the day in the mercy of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. This is your brother again, Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa.